gentlemen, welcome back to the Handy Randy Show. We're on a task, and that is we're jumping into the Wayback Machine, and we're taking you back to yesteryear and showing you antique and historical trucks, not cars, not muscle cars, not antique cars, but trucks. Now, they don't have to be pickup trucks either. They don't have to be panel trucks. They can be big trucks, and there's a lot of folks out there that A, are a member of this wonderful organization, that if you own an antique truck, you should consider finding out about joining the American Truck Historical Society. They have meetings in our area. I've attended a couple of those meetings, and there are wonderful collections right in our own backyard. They don't have to be, as I mentioned, they don't have to be great big trucks. They can be state body trucks. They can be pickup trucks. And interesting story that I've learned from this series on the truck, the life of the truck, and that is originally the pickup trucks were nothing like the pickup trucks we drive today that are $40,000 and $50,000. They were inexpensive, and they did a utility job, and that was go to the hardware store, buy some bags of grain, throw them in the back of the truck, and bring them back to the ranch or the farm. And that's what they were used for. Not anything like our pickup trucks of today. And the panel delivery vehicles were used for funeral homes, florists, the Divco milk trucks, we've learned about them. And they were all served a purpose, and most of them led a very difficult life and died at an early age. Those pickup trucks, they didn't survive. Some of them did, but not very many. So appreciate the fact when you see an antique truck around that they've probably lived a pretty hard life and pretty beat up, just like me. So enjoy the life and times of American trucks.
Around the show. Our first stop will be at this beautiful 1951 LJ Mack, owned by 17-year ATHS member George Humphrey. In the 11 years that George has owned the truck, he has managed to add an additional 60,000 miles to the odometer just driving it to shows. George will conclude with an interesting story about his grandfather's 1919 steam engine that the family has preserved.
This particular truck that I'm leaning against here is a 1951 LJ Mack. They were manufactured from 1940 until 1956. This was one of the larger over-the-road models. Mack made larger models, but anything larger than this was usually used off-highway. They manufactured about 13,000 of these from 1940 till 1956. I drove truck as a young man of 19, and at that time, these LJs were king of the highway. And I guess that's the reason that when I got into antique trucks, I wanted an LJ. It rides good, and it's got a large cab. And that was my reason for choosing an LJ Mack. I've had an interest in trucks since I was a small kid. My dad was a mechanic for many years for International Harvester. I also run a restoration shop in Gray, Maine, and have had the pleasure of bringing back some history for a lot of these old trucks. It's an interesting hobby, and you meet some mighty fine people.
Hi, folks. We're on a series of the American truck, and we were just discussing as we were off the air that the folks out there now that are out buying that brand new pickup truck that is 30, 40, 50, $60,000. Got a big workhorse diesel engine in it. And the last thing that they would ever do is put something in the bed of that truck. Don't do that. So why the heck are you buying a pickup truck for? It's a pickup truck. They're not like they used to be. When Henry Ford first decided to put a bed on the back of that Model T, that thing was used for everything, including they used it as a tractor. Yes, they did. They put some different tires on it and took that Model T and took it out and plowed with it and pulled with it. And a lot of these great old rigs that we're watching led a very difficult life and really did a lot of work on our highways. And appreciate the fact that there's folks out there that are restoring these old rigs and bringing them back to life, so and sharing them with us like I'm doing here on the Handy Randy Show.
Corbett Motor Truck Company of Henderson, North Carolina, was a formidable builder of trucks. Corbett supplied many trucks to the war effort in the 40s, and until the early 50s sold a large number of road tractors. Things got pretty tricky for International in the early 80s, but they were certainly one of the survivors. International always seemed to have a fundamental way of accommodating their customers. Maybe that's most obvious in the fact that their medium-duty trucks weren't beefed-up pickups, but rather heavy-duty trucks with the necessary alterations for a lighter application.
Robertson from Jerome, Arizona, and a bunch of guys told me I couldn't put a 300 supercharged engine in a little truck like this, so I did it. And we started on it about a year ago with just a pile of parts laying on the ground, and we finished it up last Thursday morning. I slammed the door, climbed in, slammed the door, and headed for North Carolina, 2,000 miles away, and we made it over here. And before I left, my wife gave me a big old hug and some money and said, why don't you take the other woman and go away for about 3 weeks? So that's what I did. So, I decided if I was going to build my own truck, I always wanted one with lots of gears in it. And this poor old truck is so short that the only number of gears I could get in it is 78 gears. So that's what I did. I got a 13-speed and a 3-speed Brownie and a 2-speed rear end. And I live down in Arizona where it gets really hot sometimes in the summer, and they got big old mountains down there to go up. And I've been known to haul a load a time or two up the mountains, so I wanted to keep her cool. So you can see on the back, I put an auxiliary radiator on it, because the one in the front is about the size of an ordinary pickup radiator. So I got two radiators, and it seems to keep it really nice and cool. And I got it geared so at 70 miles an hour, I'm running 1,425 RPM. So it's just nice for cruising. And in 98, we want to invite you all down to Arizona for the truck convention and truck show. And while we're there, they'll have a tour up to the Gold King Mine in Ghost Town, which is my establishment, and you'll all enjoy that.
Thank you.
So before we pack up the trucks and say goodbye, our new ATHS president, Bob King, has a few thoughts to share.
We're at Greensboro, North Carolina, and this is our 18th annual truck show, 26th anniversary, actually, of ATHS. We're at Volvo GM. They have been absolute wonderful hosts. They've got all grass for the trucks to be parked on. They've really taken care of all of our needs. The Piedmont chapter, where the host chapter, I know Sharp was the has been the chairman. He's the guy who used to have a lot of hair, and he doesn't have any more. But we're having a lot of fun. And this truck show is about show, and it's also about people. Everybody gets together and have a good time. And most of you people, if you're our ETH member, you have your Wheels of Time, your little Bible here. But don't forget, for the last 3 years, this will be the fourth year, we have a book called Showtime, and it lists all the trucks that qualify as an antique truck. It's all the trucks on this book, and it's for sale through the National or anyplace else. We've had absolute beautiful weather. The estimated rain, anticipated rain, at Sunday afternoon at 1:10, or 4:10, I guess it's 4:10. It looks to me like we might make it. We've had a few sprinkles, but we've had a really, really beautiful show. And there's an in excess of 600 trucks on display. And this is one of the newer antique trucks. Just think 50 years down the road, this will be an antique.
A lot of work goes into putting together a show like this, not the least of which is transporting the trucks to and from the event. The guy who invented the chain binder, although he was clever, must have been a sadistic character.
The 18,000 members of the American Truck Historical Society dedicate themselves to the collection and preservation of the dynamic history of trucks, the trucking industry, and its pioneers. This year is no exception. In fact, this is a very special year for the American Truck Historical Society, otherwise known as ATHS. It marks the 25th anniversary for the organization. And this is the first year that a corporation has hosted the annual convention. The convention was held at Dana Corporation's Technical Resource Park in Ottawa Lake, Michigan. Dana is a global leader in the engineering, manufacturing, and distribution of products and systems for the vehicular, industrial, and mobile off-highway markets. With 46,000 employees operating facilities in 29 countries, Dana is proud to be the first corporate host of this unique convention. This year's show drew over 700 trucks from all parts of North America and was attended by an estimated 30,000 spectators. So sit back and enjoy this video as we take you to the trucks of yesterday displayed at the 1996 National Antique Truck Show. Here's ATHS President Richard Schaefer.
Hi, I'm Dick Schaefer, President of the American Truck Historical Society. Welcome to our 25th annual convention, incorporating our 17th annual truck show. Our society was formed in 1971. It was incorporated as a not-for-profit organization whose purpose was and still is to collect, maintain, and preserve the fine history of the trucks and the trucking industry in our country. We also held our first truck show. This was held in Sarasota, Florida, and 26 trucks were present. I think you'll see later on in this film that this humble beginning of a truck show has grown to a national event. Today we expect over 700 examples of our fine history of trucks in the U.S. Thank you and enjoy this tape.
While the last of the trucks are rolling in, let's visit with former ATHS President Al Koenig as he discusses the origins of the trucking industry.
The evolution of the motor carrier industry in North America has indeed been a very interesting history. There have been many pioneers who we owe a great debt of gratitude to, who were the pioneers in the development of the motor truck as we know it. Because of the development of the motor truck, we were able to create a transportation network in this country, which has allowed the United States to be a leader in virtually every field. Many of the manufacturers that we see today have contributed many innovative ideas, from engines to transmissions to drive lines. The motor carrier industry actually evolved from the drayage companies, which were in existence prior to the motor truck. In about the year 1900, motor trucks started appearing on many streets of metropolitan areas. However, trucks were not designed at that time to travel very far, and as shippers required truckers to move farther, this required the development of many components that which would allow the transcontinental movement of freight. Many trucking companies, predecessors of some of the large companies today, really pioneered the building of highways in this country. And as the needs for motor trucks continued, the highway system as we know today evolved from those needs. I think the common bond that we have, or the common thread of the growth of the industry, is answered by the needs of the various shippers who have a specific need, and the industry has stepped forward. What does the future hold? Only our imaginations can give us the direction in that respect.
Let's take a stroll around the show. Our first stop will be at this beautiful 1951 LJ Mack, owned by 17-year ATHS member George Humphrey. In the 11 years that George has owned the truck, he has managed to add an additional 60,000 miles to the odometer just driving it to shows. George will conclude with an interesting story about his grandfather's 1919 steam engine that the family has preserved.
This particular truck that I'm leaning against here is a 1951 LJ Mack. They were manufactured from 1940 until 1956. This was one of the larger over-the-road models. Mack made larger models, but anything larger than this was usually used off-highway. They manufactured about 13,000 of these from 1940 till 1956. I drove truck as a young man of 19, and at that time, these LJs were king of the highway. And I guess that's the reason that when I got into antique trucks, I wanted an LJ. It rides good, and it's got a large cab. And that was my reason for choosing an LJ Mack. I've had an interest in trucks since I was a small kid. My dad was a mechanic for many years for International Harvester. I also run a restoration shop in Gray, Maine, and have had the pleasure of bringing back some history for a lot of these old trucks. It's an interesting hobby, and you meet some mighty fine people. This one-cylinder engine on the back of this 1924 AB Mack is kind of an interesting piece of history. As you know, the Cummins Engine Company was started around 1919 and 1920. In the early days of the Cummins Engine Company, Clessie Cummins made a contract with Hercules Engine to make these diesel engines for him. Sears Roebuck was the sole sales agent. My grandfather, in about 1919 or 1920, bought this 7 horsepower Cummins engine, which they called the Thermoil, from Sears and Roebuck, and he bought it to saw wood with. Now, the engines were sold with a money-back warranty. And in 1920, it was quite a job to keep a gasoline engine running, let alone a diesel. So many of these engines got shipped back to the factory because they were built on a gas chassis, and the head bolts was not strong enough to hold the compression of the diesel. And a Cummins man told me that at one time there were more of these engines coming back into the factory than was shipped out, and that the only one that made any money on them was the drayage people that hauled them away and hauled them back. And a large sum of money was lost on the manufacture of this engine. And if my history is right, I think that the Cummins Engine Company operated for about 10 years before it ever made a profit.
I hope you're enjoying this series on the life and times of the American truck. Way back in the early years, these big, huge trucks with solid rubber tires did not have power steering. And my father-in-law told me that his father was a truck driver and drove those big rigs back then. And the truck drivers had arms, guns like this big, bigger than mine. Oh, okay, quiet now. Huge, huge arms, because they took that giant steering wheel that was 20 inches or so, wooden steering wheel, and the larger the steering wheel, the easier it was to turn those great big old rigs, and they worked out their arms every single day, no power steering. Can you imagine running those rigs down the road? And now they've got them so that there's power brakes, there's power steering, there's power shifting, but still a difficult job. But I hope, again, you're appreciating this series on the American truck, and think about joining that wonderful group, the American Truckers Historical Society. Enjoy.
Let's stop to take a closer look at a rare 1925 Model 40 Gottfredson owned by Marcia McCrary. Although this is the first year they've brought a truck to the show, Marcia and her husband have been ATHS members since 1992.
We got interested in Gottfredson trucks because of me. I got a new computer, and wanted to write about how the roads in Superior Township, which is in Washtenaw County, about 45 miles north of here. And I picked Gottfredson Road, but I couldn't find anybody named Mr. Gottfredson who lived on this land that Gottfredson Road runs by. There was a Gottfredson Land Company, so we talked to a fellow who owned a Model T, and my husband used to trade Model T parts with him. And he said, no, Mr. Gottfredson never lived there. And then he uttered these fateful words, but you know he made a truck. And my husband said, gee, I just saw a Gottfredson truck in the Antique Power magazine that was for sale. It was a Cruise auction. It was the Marhanka auction over in Dowagiac. So I called Cruise auction and talked to them, and they told me about Stan Doyle, who's down in Oklahoma, and they told me about Ed Thornton, who lives up near Toronto, and that Ed was putting together material for a book. So I wrote to Ed, and Ed wrote to me, and he came here, and we went over there, and we then bought a 1927 Gottfredson Bickel fire truck. We had seen this truck, but we thought it was too expensive. We thought we could find a different one. And that was in 1992 that we bought the Gottfredson Bickel. In 93, we bought a wrecker from up near Corunna. And then last year, we bought this one in July. It belonged to Louis Newman, who lived in Milan. And for a while, it was at the Gibraltar Trade Center on Eureka Road over right near Detroit. So we've had this one a year. It actually is a movie star. It was in the Hoffa movie, it was in the Billy Bathgate movie, and in the Indiana Jones series. It's a 1925 Godfredson. Our wrecker is a 26, and the fire truck is a 27. All three of them have Buddha engines. This is either a KBUI or an EBUI, and the wrecker has the other one. I always confuse them. And the Godfredson Bickel has a Buddha GL6 engine. We also have a 1918 Model T here that my husband has had for 40 years. So we're just enjoying it through. The neatest thing about this is that I can go to the library and my husband can go out to the workshop, and he works on the trucks, and then we come home and we have fun things to talk about together and to share. And we really enjoy that a lot.
We also had a chance to talk to Tom Spence of Warren, New Jersey, about his 1939 Model BX Mack and the interesting piece of equipment it's hauling. Tom is in the business of restoring antique trucks and has been a member of ATHS for 12 years.
This is my own truck behind us here. It's a 1939 Mack Model BX. It's a Riggers truck. I found the truck about 12 years ago in New Jersey. The truck was originally owned by George Atwell Foundation Company in New York City. They were a foundation building company. As a matter of fact, this truck was bought by Atwell to work on the Radio City Music Hall in New York when it was built. I restored the truck. I found it in a junkyard, restored the truck about 12 years ago, as I said. And I've been taking it to shows ever since. The truck is a Riggers truck, as I had said before. The body looks like it's bent in the back, kind of sloped down, and it was made that way. It's called a camelback body. The reason being, what they would do is put ramps on the back of this truck. There's a winch right behind the cab, and they would pull machinery, heavy machinery, up onto the deck. So being the deck is curved as it is in the back, it just brought the entire load closer to the ground till they could get it up onto the truck. It is a C-cab truck, as you can see. There's no roll-up windows or anything. What they would do is put isinglass curtains in the sides there, in the openings in the wintertime to keep the weather out. Here we have a 6-horsepower single-cylinder gas engine and a winch. Now, this would have been used by riggers back in the 20s and 30s. This is skid mounted, as you can see on these big timbers. What you would do is tie that cable off to something. You can actually pull this winch either on or off the truck, pull it around inside of a building, fasten it to a column inside of a building, and you can pull heavy machinery to the winch. What they would do is work this on a second or third floor of a big factory or something when they're trying to move machinery, bring it to the elevator, bring it down, and then they would winch it up on a truck like this to move it. Behind the cab of this truck is also a winch, and that would pull the machinery up onto the truck. And that's basically what this truck was moved for. This engine and winch were built in 1912. They've been together ever since. The engine is a domestic gas engine, 6-horsepower, built in Shippensburg, Pennsylvania. The winch is Stroudsburg Engine Works, built in Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania. But they were shipped as a pair, as a unit, in 1912. And I restored them about maybe 20 years ago. Originally, they came off a barge. The old barges both used pumps and winches. They would move this. They'd have a gin pole or something on the barge, and they would use this engine and winch to move heavy machinery on and off of barges. This came from, it would have probably been used in the Hudson River, New York City area. I got it out of the Passaic River. It was on a barge.
Douglas Higgins and his brother Glenn have been collecting antique trucks for several years. This year, they were able to bring 6 trucks to the show, including this all-original 1942 International Oil Field truck, which is suspended by Glenn's B83 Mack. Here's Doug to tell us more.
This is a 42 International Oil Field truck. And same driver drove it from 1942 to 1978 and supposedly put over 1 million miles on it. And when he retired, they gave him the truck, and he built a building in his backyard in town and stored the truck in the building. And he's handicapped, and he couldn't come to the show, but he kind of selected me to get this truck because I'm nearby, and he thought maybe I would kind of preserve it and not change it and take care of it. And it was kind of his pet truck, and he was looking for a new home for it before he can't take care of it anymore. And so I kind of promised him I'd kind of keep it inside and use it once in a while and not repaint it. And this other oil field truck has got it suspended with a weight indicator. That's a B83 Mack. The other oil field truck belongs to my brother Glenn. And he thinks it will pick between 30 and 40,000 pounds of weight. And it's 37 feet long and 10 feet wide. And we've been working on it this winter trying to get ready for show, and we didn't get it completed, but we got the cab front end pretty well straightened out on it.
This year's show saw many freshly restored trucks like this gorgeous 1947 Sterling owned by Dick Best of New Waterford, Ohio. Dick has been a member of the Black Swamp chapter of ATHS for 5 years and says that it has taken nearly all that time to complete this truck.
We decided we'd bring something kind of different to this show. This 1947 Sterling, which we've been working on for about 5 years, and just finally got it underway and got it on the road, and this is an excellent place to display it for the first time. This truck was given to us approximately 6 or 8 years ago by a friend of mine who was going to cut it up and haul it off to the scrapyard. His father had used the truck for many years hauling heavy machinery, and he often told the story about taking it to a particular job where they had called in an auto car to move this huge drag line down off of a mountain in Pennsylvania, and when they hooked the auto car up to it, the first thing they did was tear out both rear ends. So then the fellow said, well, I've got a bigger Mack, he says, it'll handle the job, and they brought a DM 800 Mack in to take the place of the auto car, and hooking it up and trying to move it, they corkscrewed the drive shafts out of it. So about that time, Bob Grimm says, well, it's time to go home and get the Sterling so we can move this shovel. So Bill got in the pickup, drove home, got the Sterling and brought it over. Next thing you know is they tied onto it. Down the hill went the shovel and up the other side of the mountain and on down to the main highway with everything else taking a beating on the way. So that was one very interesting part of the history of this truck. And it's probably moved many, many heavy buildings and railroad equipment and stuff in its day. Probably one of our biggest challenges during the whole restoration was trying to find a set of new tires that were of the right era for the truck. And we finally accomplished that and got the truck all finished up here with it, maybe about a week ago. So we've had a very good time with the truck, and it'll be a lot of fun yet, because the next place it'll be displayed will be Henry Ford Museum over Father's Day weekend.
Thanks for watching another edition of the Handy Randy Show. And if you've liked what you see, you can go onto YouTube, onto, again, here's a YouTube position, Handy Randy T.V. Lipscomb. My last name is Lips in a Comb. Handy Randy T.V. Lipscomb for all of these series on trucks and cars and antiques and you name it, right here on the Handy Randy Show. Thanks for watching, folks.